Yes, come on with it. Yeah. That antenna? You talking about that antenna?
Yeah.
No, that is not my antenna. That I am just using that as an illustration because it shows the coil, the coax that I will be building. I think that it's a serial antenna.
Oh, okay.
Made in Italy. I did give the website at that site you were requesting. No, I did not make that. That's, in my opinion, an inferior design because it uses a metal can. And you can't have any metal next to the coil because it's a magnetic field device. And the magnets, the magnetic field will be disrupted by the metal.
10-4.
I believe that he used that as a coil form. And then after he secured it with the ties, he removed the can.
Yeah, that's more fair on what you're telling me. That's a pretty good setup, though, with the PVC. I got a lot of that stuff around. That looks like it's easy to make and looks professional and looks like it'll hold up real well.
Yeah, I just made one for portable use. I'm going to do some testing on it. I'm making two more designs. One of them is going to be bolted to the base of the tower, and it's going to be a little bit larger than the one you see at the base of that antenna, but they should prove some worth as far as stopping the RF fields here in the shack.
10-4.
Many tests have to be done, trial and error, you know, add a coil, delete a coil, it'll take some time, but I've got to share several designs from YouTube and various web pages. And hopefully it'll stop the squealing in the station.
Well, I'm not hearing anything today. Of course, you're not as loud as you normally are, so I guess you don't have anything running with your radio.
How's that? That should have started. Yeah, it sometimes it squeals and sometimes it doesn't. And I suspect with all the problems I have with the Cobra 2000 squealing every day for no apparent reason, I think it's the high RF fields in the shack, and that's being caused by the common mode currents. Central California standing by. St. Louis, Missouri, be quiet. Anything else?
No, I didn't want to ask you about that. It's hard to hear you with all that other skip coming in on 19, but may I go back down to Sesame Street?
Okay, I'll be making videos on these particular devices and explaining what I'm doing, so look out for them. My 100th video is coming up, and it'll be in Hillsboro, Missouri at the AT&T Microwave Relay Station. That one should be fun. I hope the weather's good. All right, catch you back the other one. How's it going? It's about time I talk to the camera. Hey, Challenger here in St. Louis, Missouri, and it's a ridiculous time. It's 12:24 in the afternoon here, and it's kind of overcast and cloudy, kind of high humidity, but the weather is cool. The temperature is cool, so the wood is expanding here at the old Pond D. It makes the doors creaky and it makes them hard to close, and The steps creak a lot because they've expanded with the additional humidity in the air. Fortunately, it doesn't affect anything here at the station, but something that it does affect here at the station, something that has been messing with me forever and ever. And I think you're familiar with the problem. Does the word Cobra 2000 come to mind? How about microphone squeal? Cobra 2000 and microphone squeal. Still battling that, because now, hey, it started on the Navajo. I have a ground on the Turner Plus 3 here, because sometimes it squeals. So I clip a rudimentary ground that's got a bus bar right there, and that runs to a 6-gauge wire that runs to 3 10-foot copper ground rods driven into the ground right out here in the back 40. And sometimes I connect it to that thing and it stops to squeal. Sometimes I disconnect it and it stops to squeal. I've been reading and checking out a lot of different information about RF fields, and in particular common mode currents on coax. Now, I've known about RF chokes for a long time. I know you have too. But I never really gave them much thought. Things are changing my mind on this frontier of not new ideas, but something new to me and something that's easily utilized. What was I talking about? Oh yeah, common mode currents. So I was reading, you know, that sometimes these other ham operators and various types of radio ops take their antenna and take this coil of coax and mount it just below the feed point of the antenna. Whereas the coax comes up from the ground, goes into the coil right there on a form, most likely PVC, 4 inches in diameter or more than what I'm designing, 4 or 5 inches. Enough to hold maybe 12 to 25 turns depending on your frequency, but usually about 20 turns, 25, 6500. It wraps around this form and then comes out and goes up into the antenna. So what you've got is an RF choke that stops the currents, common mode currents, which are currents that flow along the shield only of the coax. The coax has a outer conductor called the shield. It's usually composed of copper braid. Well, there is such a thing in these currents and in these types of RF frequency voltages called the skin effect. The skin effect allows these currents to only travel on the outside of the conductor, not inside the conductor, not through the conductor, but only on the surface of the conductor. So, being that as it is, these currents that are bouncing back from your, if you have an amplifier, from your amplifier, from your transmitter, from your exciter, up to your antenna, but then they bounce back, travel on the surface of your coax shield, the braid there, that's shield, and comes back and creates all kinds of havoc, such as microphone squeal. If you're using a D104, you can get an RF burn. If you accidentally are using a D104 and you're talking close to it, and you accidentally touch your mouth to it, you can get an RF burn right there on your lip. The D104 is notorious for that because of its all-metal construction and it is so superb. But this is just a few problems that can be had. TBI can be caused by it and exacerbated by it. Radio frequency interference and electromagnetic interference can all be problems. Your stereos, your iPods, your computers, laptops are notorious for freezing in the neighborhood of where there's RF currents happening, common mode currents. Laptops really do that a lot, what I understand. So the thing is to build these chokes, which allow it to stop. Those currents do not go through the choke. The choke creates a magnetic field, and that field within the coils cancels out those common mode currents, and they do not exit the choke. They stop in the choke and are dissipated. That is another thing that I have thought about. Perhaps, and I know I have high RF levels over here, sometimes higher than others when I'm running amplifiers or whatnot. So this is one thing that I've taken upon myself to try. And I'm going to build various types. Here's one that I just built. This is a coaxial RF choke to cancel out common mode currents. Now this is built with an RG58 cable. RG58. I built this one as a test and as a expedient use in the field. Use it in your car, use it in your truck, wherever you need it, because it's easy to use. It won't handle a lot of power because it's using this inferior RG58. A lot of them like to use the RG8X. RG8X is trash as far as I'm concerned. A lot of people like to use it though. I hate it. So this only needs coax connectors on it, and it will be enabled. This will allow you to insert it between your RF amplifier and your exciter, or anywhere in the line after your bird watt meter, before the antenna, after the antenna, wherever you need it, wherever you think it might do good. This will provide an RF choke, hopefully, to do the job. But this one is a very small prototype that I just built because I saw some on YouTube that were very enticing, very, very robust in construction. And I like that. So, that's nice. My next one, though, pardon me. Hello? The next one will be wound on a coil form like this. It's a little bit bigger. Almost drop it in there. A little bit bigger than that one, but it will be wound with this. A little bit dusty. Already has one coax connector on it. This form will get wound on this. This will take some time in doing. I'll probably do this out in the front yard. I've got to drill some holes and use wire ties and drum up all that I can muster. Drum up all the gusto I can. Because I feel that one right there, this one right here, is going to be a little bit of a challenge. Winding that one, that small one, that was fun. That was kind of fun. Not a big challenge, and well worth the effort. I tacked it down a little bit with some hot glue on both sides of each side, just to go ahead and maintain integrity. I like that one. That's going to do a good job. I have a good feeling about that. But this one's going to be next, and then after this, I'll perform some tests on this. Then the one that goes at the base of the tower, which I'll be building out of a much larger form, probably a six inch one. That'll be beautiful. And about 20 turns of some international 9086. Be difficult because it's solid center conductor. So that's what's going on. I'll get back to you as I do the next one. You'll be sure to say, hey, maybe I should build one of those. You never know, it might help. Or, you know, you never know what it could do. It's just an easy little device that I'm intrigued by because nothing else has worked on that squealing situation. And I think this is going to be the savior that I've been looking for. So, get back to me on that, you know what I'm saying? Leave your comments, suggestions, critiques, criticisms, and all that other good stuff here at YouTube. And I sure appreciate everything you do for me. Thanks for watching. Challenger here at the radio station, St. Louis, Missouri, say 73. And I'll be showing you that big one here soon. That's right. Bye-bye now.